Hey, everybody. Well, Michael Rowlands is at it again. He started another series trying to critique Sargon of Akkad's Why Do People Hate Feminism 2, Patriarchy. Well, I'm going to be doing another expose of his nonsense, and this time I'm going to be nice and not do any cursing, unless, of course, Sir Strawface tries to act holier than thou, or says bigoted stuff, or is snide, or does any sort of doublethink, or is hypocritical in any way. You know, the stuff that really pisses me off. Fuck, who am I kidding? This is going to be just as ugly, if not worse, than before. But I am going to try to spend a little more time presenting information that will turn Sir Strawface's straw men into shambling mounds, which will hopefully turn on him and muffle out this chaotic, stupid vassal of Queen Matriarchy. All right, let's crack this nut.
Why do anti-feminists hate feminism? Subtitled, Sargon's Inability to Research. Because that's basically what this is. Just a big documentation of how god-awful that man is at doing research. Just depressingly bad.
Well, Sir Strawface, in your last series, you did zilch for research. And you cited, well, how do we say it? Feminist blog sites like everydayfeminism.com and feministing.com. So we'll see if you did any better this time. Well, I must say, my calling you out on your hypocritic bullshit seems to have stirred your lazy ass into a bit of citations here. Very good. We'll dig into this a little bit later and see if this constitutes research. But at least now you're citing sources other than feminist blog sites. But before we go on to your commentary, let's just take a look at what Sargon wrangled up in terms of citations for his video. All right, it looks like he has an abundance of citations here. Please proceed with your argument.
Right, enough of that. Let's get on to this pulsating arsehole. I mean, totally awesome, cool guy that I definitely want to be friends with.
Welcome to part two of Why Does Everyone Hate Feminism? The first reason that people hate feminism is that feminists hate men, and they hate men because of something they call the patriarchy. Of course, before we can go any further, we need to define our terms. What is a patriarchy? Now, any normal person would probably go and look for the standard English definition. So when a feminist says to the uninitiated that we live in a patriarchy, they're thinking that a patriarchy is a form of social organization in which the father is the supreme authority in the family, clan, or tribe, and descent is reckoned in the male line, with the children belonging to the father's clan or tribe. And by the second definition, this produces a society, community, or country based on this social organization.
If you type patriarchy definition into Google, literally the second definition that comes up right at the top of the fucking page is a system of society or government in which men hold the power and women are largely excluded from it.
So what? Really? So what? Sargon goes through, what, 12 different sources in an attempt to nail down the feminist definition of patriarchy? So how is it that the 1001 definitions that he didn't put up on the screen takes away from his general claim? That being that the term patriarchy is nebulous and even feminists don't agree on the definition. God damn, your idiocy is just beyond description. The more examples you find, the more you prove his point, dumbass. Sir Strawface, Sargon is not arguing here that the definition he found was the right and only definition. He was just showing it's a common definition that aligns with the general perception of non-feminists. And who says Sargon used Google? Maybe he did, maybe he didn't, I don't know. And if you use Google, you do get the definition you pointed out. But I don't use Google. Usually I use ixquick.com because it's more private and it tends to give me what I'm looking for more often. And there's other search engines. So people don't always use Google for their search engine. The fact that you think that you have to do research by using Google shows that you have blinders on. This is a big problem for you and a big problem for feminists. You have to be able to consider things from different angles, not just the first angle that pops up in your head. And to further Sargon's point, let's just take a look at three of the most popular online dictionaries and what they say the patriarchy is. And you'll see that those definitions don't line up exactly. But in each case, you see that the definition pretty much lines up with the definitions that Sargon started out with, which are the common man definitions of patriarchy, so to speak. And if you recall the main thesis of Sargon's entire series, the main idea that runs through this, it's why does the general public, or why does 80% of the public, not identify as feminists? In his videos, he needs to keep going back to what the general population sees, what the general population thinks, and contrast that with what the general population will think is the lunacy of feminism. That's what he's doing.
I went to the link that he provided of his definition that he found, and this was the third definition on the list, but he cut it off before he put it into his video. What a deceptive prick. Just the biggest, deceptivest prick you've ever met. And you, God, dude, later on in the video, he does this. Oh, no, wait, I don't want to ruin it. It's awesome. He one-ups himself. He teen-ups himself. You just wait, it's delicious.
Well, that was a poor choice. I will give you that. But as to being deceptive, no. No, he's not being deceptive. He goes over numerous definitions of patriarchy and the numerous ways that it's explained. Most likely, he cut it out to simply draw focus on the commonly understood definitions of patriarchy. You would be right only if he didn't cover all the various definitions of patriarchy, but he most certainly did. And look at you, you're all giddy as if you exposed something. Sargon covers this.
So basically, everything from this point on is irrelevant because he's attacking the wrong definition of patriarchy.
No, that's ridiculous. He covered at least 12 definitions and explanations of patriarchy, and then put them all together in a nice little summation. So you're just flat out misstating the facts. Please try to pay attention.
But he makes a bunch of stupid claims anyway, so I'll go ahead and point out why those are wrong. Again, he should pay me to be his editor. Like that's ever gonna happen.
If Sargon decides to hire an editor, don't you think he'd want to hire somebody that's actually competent?
This is going to sound quite counterintuitive to anyone who lives in the Western world, and they'll probably take to Google to see if they can find any kind of evidence to corroborate the feminist assertion that we live in a patriarchy. The first thing that they're going to discover is that marriage rates are sharply on the decline. The next thing they'll discover is that over a quarter of families are single-parent households, and the overwhelming majority of these households will be led by single mothers. They'll probably also discover that women control approximately 20% of the US government.
A whole 20%? Hide your kids! Hide your fucking husband! The women are taking over!
Okay, Sir Strawface. You are doing a great job of comedy, but you are doing a terrible job of fairly representing and addressing Sargon's point. Typical postmodern nonsense. Sargon is pointing out that when people see women at all levels of government of our society, the public is going to be scratching its head trying to figure out why we have so many women in high government offices if there's a patriarchy out there oppressing women. Seemingly, to the public, if a female candidate is qualified and competent, she has a fair shot at a government position. And newsflash, most people, once they think about it, they don't want to do the hard work of becoming a politician and exposing themselves and their families to all sorts of scrutiny and unscrupulous attacks. When you take that into consideration with the stereotypes of gender that the public largely believes in, the one that Sargon showed you, and the one that basically lists what it takes to rise to the highest offices in our nation, those are mostly masculine traits. In other words, people, right or wrong, stereotypically think that men are more willing to be involved in the soul-sucking enterprise of politics. And when women do take the field, they often are victorious. So the public is going to be hard-pressed to imagine that there's an invisible, oppressive patriarchy under these circumstances.
I googled this figure, and I found something rather humorous. The US are number 69... No, that's not the humorous part. The US are number 69 in the top-ranking percentage of women in their government list. Now, that's fine. But the US ranks behind such countries as Tajikistan, Pakistan, Afghanistan, and Uganda. That's right, ladies and gentlemen. The US have less percentage of women in their government than Tajikistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Uganda. But no. Women in the West have nothing to complain about. They have equality. They've totally got equality. We should be focusing on the women in the East. Why aren't feminists fucking over there trying to solve all their problems? Because everyone over here is sorted. There's no problems at all. Fuck off, you dickhead.
Well, this seems like a perfect time to go into the depth of your research there, Sir Strawface. Let's just take a look at it, shall we? Okay, well, we got here an article from the Daily Kos. The first thing we want to ask ourselves is, what kind of source is the Daily Kos? Okay, it's an American political blog that publishes news and opinions from a liberal point of view. It functions as a discussion forum and a group blog for a variety of Netroots activists whose efforts are primarily directed towards influencing and strengthening progressive policies and candidates. Well, that doesn't sound like a credible source, but maybe they're just reporting on something that's legit, so let's just give it a go here. Well, it says here the United States currently ranks 69th in the percentage of women serving in the government at all levels. And it's a dead link. Great. So, Sir Strawface, what happened here? You didn't click this link, did you? You just read this excerpt verbatim and took it as the gospel. Isn't that the truth? That's all you did, being the great scholar and researcher that you purport to be. You obediently parroted Tajikistan, Pakistan, Afghanistan, and Uganda, and boom, you were out of there like a jet fighter dodging a heat seeker. Well, if that's not enough to convince your subscribers of your shoddy research habits, and that you are a complete, total hypocrite for claiming that Sargon and others are shoddy researchers, well, let's just recall how giddy you were about this hilarious 69 number before moving on.
I googled this figure, and I found something rather humorous. The US are number 69. No, that's not the humorous part. The US have less percentage of women in their government than Tajikistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Uganda.
Unfortunately for you, your juvenile joy about the number 69 and your premature ejaculation at the thought of third world countries being more egalitarian than the mighty United States exposes you as the pea-brained child you are. And your exposure as a fool only gets worse, bub, because had you scrolled down here, you would have found a link where the U.S. ranks 80th as far as the U.S. Congress or our parliament-like system goes, and that link happens to work. You gave one citation, and you couldn't even bother reading the whole thing or clicking on the links. Some research. Now who's the one that's deceptive? The guy that finds a biased blog site, cherry-picks a claim off that website, and then tries to pass it off as proven? Or the guy that goes to multiple sites, states the opponent's ideological position in their own words, and then carefully summarizes those positions fairly accurately, and then demonstrates how those positions may run counter to the perspective of the general public? It's just a question, hypocrite. Now, if I was like you, I would have left it right there and let you swing on the vine. But despite you being a piece of shit researcher, there's nevertheless some information here that needs to be considered. That's what an objectivist does, a rationalist. He will try to account for all relevant criticism and concerns. So I'm not going to be a postmodernist evasion deceit monger like you fuckers. Instead, like Sargon did in his video, I'm going to try to lay out the opposition's position fairly. Anyway, this link leads to a list that is maintained by the Inter-Parliamentary Union, which is, well, I did a bit of poking around here off camera, and it looks like a progressive UN ally. In other words, a hypocritical, cultural, Marxist body that loves to denigrate the U.S. for trumped-up human rights violations, while at the same time putting Iran in charge of such commissions. It's that sort of Orwellian doublespeak and structure that we're dealing with here. But anyway, in this list, the U.S. actually ranks 95th as 2016, not 80th. So if you'd bothered to double-check the 2012 article from the Daily Kos, you would have been able to present up-to-date information that makes the silly United States look even sillier from your point of view. I did a spot check on this information for the U.S., Afghanistan, Pakistan, Tajikistan, and New Zealand, and as near as I can tell, it's accurate within a percentage point. You can duplicate what I did by following the links in the low bar. But as I said, your Daily Kos article was from 2012, and the list at the IP website, it's updated through 2016. So Tajikistan now has a lower ratio of female parliamentarians than the U.S. Anyway, for all of these other countries listed here in the Daily Kos article, those all have seats reserved for women. Afghanistan has 68 seats reserved, Pakistan 60 reserved, Uganda, I couldn't quite tell, but it looks like 116 reserved for women. Now, all of this would, from your point of view, shore up your general claim that the patriarchy still holds most of the power in the West. And I fearlessly and happily point this out, because these are the facts, as best I can tell. I don't need to hide from them like a cowardly vassal of Queen Feminism. A modernist can accept facts even though they challenge his existing conclusions. So, Sir Strawface, we finally arrive at the point where we can honestly think about Sargon's position regarding the patriarchy in relation to your counterpoint. In other words, are women being oppressed by a patriarchy in the West because 27% of Afghanistan's parliament is held by women and only 20% of the U.S. Congress is held by women? Well, I have to say your argument is not very convincing at all. Women outnumber men here in the U.S., and they more often than not vote for men. Well, you might say, I suppose, that the institutionalized patriarchy teaches internalized misogyny. Well, frankly, that's bullshit. Citation needed. I made a video on our public education system. I will have a link in the low bar to it. But our schools are designed to empower girls and women. So much so that the girls are graded higher than boys. Boys are the ones being told that they are stupid by the system. Boys drop out of school more often than girls. Women enroll in college and get college degrees more often than men. So it doesn't appear that women are taught internal misogyny. That's bullshit. From kids' media programming to teen shows to comedy shows and advertising, it's men more often than not that are portrayed as incompetent and the women are portrayed as being more capable and fixing things that men get wrong. So, Sir Strawface, you might ask, what's going on then? Well, I'm glad you asked. First, you dipshit, you have internalized misandry. Second, women are just not as interested in being political leaders as you would like to force them to be. Third, you're not fighting institutional patriarchy, you are fighting biology. Women in the aggregate are more interested in being nurturers, socializing and enjoying a comfortable life than they are in being involved in cutthroat politics. And the source of that biology? They bear children, and it gives most women a different life emphasis than most men. Women have the right to vote and hold all public offices here in the U.S. They choose not to, even though they are encouraged throughout all of their years to pursue whatever career they choose. They choose the life that suits them, or they don't put in the effort needed to have the life that they want. That's equality. Not reserving seats for women is not patriarchy. It's equality, because reserving seats for women is discriminatory, regressive, and stupid. Those quotas are every bit as backwards as the nations you cited, namely Tajikistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Uganda. Fuck that.
And they'll find that in the world of business, the number of Fortune 500 companies that have women CEOs is higher than it's ever been. Admittedly, 24 female CEOs making up 4.8% of the overall total isn't a massive amount, but it really makes the point that there are no institutional barriers to prevent women from arriving at the top spot in a company.
Okay, so firstly, it's taken 20 years to get from 0 to 25 women CEOs. That's pretty fucking slow. At that rate, it'll take 180 years before we have an even number of men and women. Just to put that in perspective, it took 70 years to get from here to here. 70! To be fair, the rate of increase might be slightly different because I took the average over a 20-year period rather than just like a smaller segment of that. So here's a graph. So in the last 4 to 5 years, the number has increased by 8, with a drop from 2010 to 2011. Let's take it over a 4-year period and say the increase was 8. That's a rate of 2 more women CEOs per year, which is more than 0.8 per year when we're looking at a 20-year period. And that's great! Especially since, you know, 4/5 of a CEO isn't really that great of an idea. You know, they're just not very efficient, not very good at their job, without a head. They make a big mess as well. Ugh, just terrible. Awful. Great! So, faster rate of increase, that means it's gonna take less time to get to an equal number of men and women CEOs. Surely it'll be a lot less than 180. What's that? It's still gonna take 113 years. Right. So, I mean, it's still less than 180 years, I suppose. Equality?
Ooh. Well, we'll get to your research at the end of this, but I take it you have no intention of dealing with Sargon's argument that this is an indication to the public that women are no longer being oppressed and they are entering the ranks of the CEOs. You're not going to deal with that. Sir Strawman, you're not going to deal with that. I mean, I understand in a way. It's your video. You can go on to any topic that you want, but this is supposed to be a critique or a criticism or a debunking of Sargon and his overall claim why people hate feminism. And the argument that you're making is, this is why we need feminism. So instead of talking with Sargon, you're talking past him. Congratulations. I don't know, maybe you want us to infer that patriarchy is still oppressing women based on the fact that only 5% of the CEOs of the Fortune 500 are women. As in your last video, your conclusion begs the question, how many women want these positions? And how many of them have made themselves as qualified as the men in these positions? Until you marshal that evidence, Sir Strawface, you haven't made your case.
I like Sargon's little misogynistic jab there at the end. It really makes the point that there's no institutional barriers preventing women from arriving at the top spot of a company. I know, right? So it must be those women's fault, right? Those women's? Yeah. Fucking lazy women's. Just being lazy, not wanting to put any time and effort into their work. Just, you know, being lazy, you know, sitting at home and watching, like, The Notebook and breastfeeding.
Well, let me just introduce you to my little friend here called Wikipedia. There's an entry that you might want to look at. It's called List of Fallacies. We'll go down to the list of informal fallacies here. And we'll just read a few and see if any of these kind of stand out to you. So we got the appeal to the stone, which is dismissing a claim as absurd without demonstrating proof for its absurdity. And we have the argument from personal incredulity. I cannot imagine how this could be true, therefore it must be false. We also have the argument from silence, where the conclusion is based on the absence of evidence rather than the existence of evidence. And to round it out, we'll move on down to the bees and see what they have. Begging the question, providing what is essentially the conclusion of the argument as a premise. I have to ask myself, do any of these things apply to your last argument? Or was it just a straw man argument?
In fact, if you watch to the end, that's pretty much Sargon's conclusion. In his article on the New York Times website, Stephen Davidoff Solomon discusses some of the reasons why women might find it difficult to rise through the ranks to CEO. The first explanation is simple sex discrimination. Women entering the workforce are met with overt hostility. In some cases, benevolent attitudes have been found to be patronizing and can do as much harm as outright discrimination.
Yeah, it kind of sounds like you got a case of the damned if you do's and the damned if you don't's. So if you're trying to hold women back, that's discrimination. And if you're trying to help them out, that's discrimination. Damn, that patriarchy's a clever motherfucker. But here's the problem. You need a citation because I know of a graduate student that did herself a little study. And what she found out was that if men treated women the same, the women perceived it as misogyny. It was only when men put the women on a pedestal did they think they were getting treated equally. It's an interesting study. I'll have it in the low bar.
More generally, hostility is not required for discrimination to exist. In other words, stereotypes can end up creating different or lower expectations for women in the absence of hostility. And another strand of literature argues that there is not hostility towards women so much as a preference for men.
Yeah, he's talking adverse impact theory there. And I don't know, maybe there's something to it, but the only correction that I see feminists proposing that basically doesn't run afoul of the damned if you do, damned if you don't conundrum you're putting everybody in, is straight up quotas. And I'm sorry, that's just stupid. That can never work for a CEO because there's only one CEO in each company. It could work for a board, it would still be stupid, but there's no way it can work for CEOs. And if you're going to run a Fortune 500 company, you need to prove yourself, period. A lot of people's retirements and investments are riding on the line. There is absolutely no reason for the employees and shareholders to settle on the runner-up. These are not positions to fuck around with. Get the best person you can find for the job. If it's a man, it's a man. If it's a woman, it's a woman. If it's a fucking donkey, it's a donkey. That's what you do when you're looking for a CEO of a Fortune 500 company. Now, if you want to be a CEO, you can be a CEO. You can go down and start your own company and do it that way. But if you want to be a CEO of a top, top company, you need to prove yourself.
The second explanation is more complex and states that the current male-driven culture does not allow women to succeed. Women's values and approaches are different, and when entering the workforce, women find that the male culture is not to their taste or are driven off. Those women who do succeed adapt to the male culture. In other words, women need to become like men to become corporate executives. I found that second point rather interesting. The fact that a woman would have to forego many of her feminine characteristics and adopt a more masculine approach so that she can succeed in a more corporate environment. And you'll find that Sargon also agrees with this when we get closer to the end.
Well, that depends what you're talking about. If you're talking about quit whining about shit and get shit done being a man thing, then yeah, they fucking need to do that. But if you're talking about they need to have a dick and piss in a urinal, then fuck no. The thing is, Sir Strawface, everything that is masculine and everything that is attributable to the stereotypic male is not a bad thing. To view the world like that is misandry. And this is why people call feminists sexist bigots. Who the fuck are you to say that getting shit done and not whining about it is a bad thing, especially in a corporate environment? If you want to prove that those traits are bad, Citation needed. Your fucking opinion is a bigoted opinion on its face.
Another issue at the forefront involves childcare. In a large part, women still effectively function as the primary caregivers of children, and many commentators have described the struggle for work-life balance. This is true because the need to care for children is often greatest when women are in their 30s and 40s, a period which is the prime time of their careers.
So, depending on your belief system, either God or evolution is part of the patriarchy. Look, a company is looking for a great CEO. A child is looking for a great parent. Whether you're a man or a woman, you have to make those choices. If a woman chooses to be more interested in her family than being a CEO, that's her business. In fact, that's the choice that most men make as well. If she wants to choose to be less of a mother and more of a CEO, as all CEOs, whether male or female, have to, then that's her choice as well. Men are in the same exact position. It's called freedom and equality. The fact that you see this as a female issue shows your bigotry. The fact that feminists cling to their nurturing and caregiving as a feminine trait and then turn around and try to destroy gender roles whenever it suits them shows them as hypocrites. Your cult has no principles other than promoting women over men, no matter what. Your cult is a misandrist cult.
So, perhaps, maybe, potentially, this issue is a teensy-weensy, incy-bincy, spidery, little tiny bitty bit more complex than Sargon's making it out to be. Maybe. What a surprise. Am I surprised? Not really.
Look, if you want to have a civil debate, one without your snide comedy and bullshit, and without my cursing and overbearing fucking personality, then I'd be more than happy to have that debate with you. And we can get right down into the smallest details of the CEO issue. But you're not in a position to pretend that you treat issues with more depth than Sargon. A quick review of both of your channels shows how shallow your knowledge and effort is compared to Sargon's. And it's that overt and ridiculous hypocrisy that has drawn this fly to your shit.
Anyway, isn't this supposed to be an example of how men aren't the supreme rulers of the world? Like the definition of patriarchy you totally didn't cherry pick says they are? Or something? I don't really know what he was getting at with this one. Oh well, let's push on. Punch myself in the face.
Well, I guess I should thank you for at least trying to save me the trouble of doing that. Look, you fucking hypocrite. In the very breath that you accuse Sargon of being a hypocrite, you are discussing a controversial fact that he could have skipped, yet he handled it. You motherfucker, you're such a hypocrite. You cite, what, two or three sources? And you only ever bring out facts that favor your cause. And you act as if Sargon is the cherry picker. So what a great segue for us to take a look at your research. Well, let's just go down here. Let's see. Let's look at the graph first. Well, I tried this in both my browsers, and it doesn't seem to work. Well, let's look at the New York Times article then, I guess. Well, I'm not impressed. You weren't able to get a proper link to the article. Don't worry, folks. I'll find the article and put it in the low bar. All right, I found the article. I've read it. It has links to studies. It does have a feminist bent, but I think it's a pretty darn good article, and I recommend that everybody read it. But let me just cherry-pick a couple things for you to whet your appetite for it. One of the arguments that the author makes is that women do have good business acumen, and for men and women that study economics and take accounting and business courses, I have no issue with that. And so I'll just go ahead, for the sake of argument, accept that as proven. The author also makes an argument that businesses that have a more feminine corporate type of leadership do better. And he cites a single paper on that. The problem with his citation, though, is that that paper really only argues that having women as part of the top management team, which is focused on innovation, is beneficial. It really doesn't make the claim that a feminine type of style of leadership is better than a masculine type of leadership. So again, this author is into male bashing for no good reason. And this paper doesn't appear to be peer-reviewed. However, it's chocked full of good and useful information, so I do recommend reading it. However, to the author's credit, he does mention some studies done on the Norway experiment where they have quotas for the board as potentially hurting the bottom line of the company, especially if the women are less experienced. Well, fuck, duh. Jesus Christ. And another thing that's worthy of note here, I think, is that our author fails to cite these studies that are detrimental to his point. And I think this part here just bears quoting. While some studies conflict with others, in aggregate, these reports provide evidence that women have the potential to add significant value to a company. And I think that nicely sums up my preconception of women as board members and as CEOs. Just like a man, if they're good at their job, they have the potential to benefit a company. Wow, who would have thunk? So in summary, Sir Strawface, your research turned up a pro-feminist opinion. Wow, congratulations. I mean, after all, an opinion that's not backed up by any science is valid when it agrees with you, and an opinion that comes from the other direction is obviously invalid. Way to take Sargon down with your superior knowledge and research skills, you dumbass hypocrite. Look, there's really only one thing I'm looking for. It's equality of opportunity for each gender, for each sex, for each race. And in order to help bring that better day about, I'm all too happy to expose you bigots, you hypocrites, you man-haters, and you woman-haters out there. As far as I'm concerned, you're all entitled at your shot at getting a bite of my axe.
Hi! The time has come, the war said, to talk of many things. Of shoes and ships and sealing wax and Sargon's inability to string together a coherent argument.
Well, that would be a very good point to make if it was true. However, when it's not true, it just makes you look like an idiot. Sargon's point is well made. It's laid out in a logical manner. It's supported by documentation. And you're perfectly free to refute that argument, his opinion. But the idea that his arguments were incoherent compared to your nonsense? Again, you just look like a fucking idiot.
And now this. Bam!
In fact, in the business and financial worlds, it's been widely known that women control the money in the United States, holding 60% of all personal wealth and 51% of all stocks.
So I went to check out this link as well, and surprise, surprise, it's rather dodgy.
Well, you said surprise twice there. I guess that's because we got two surprises here. One, you're half right, which is a surprise because it's such a vast improvement. Of course, when you're starting out with negative credibility, it should be pretty easy to improve one's performance. The second surprise to me is that Business Insider is as fucking lazy as you are, at least on this issue, and if this is indicative of the rest of their journalism, they are a source that should be used with great care.
The sources it has either lead to other articles on the Business Insider website with titles such as 7 Simple Tips for Your New Homeowner, or it'll send you to another website which asserts these figures without any sources, or it will send you to another Business Tips Insider website thing, because reasons, I don't know, quality sourcing. Quality source.
My hat's off to you here, Strawface. That is a pretty good summary of this article. If I were to add anything to that, I would call the fucking author a lazy dumb cunt and a perfect example of why people, including Sargon, can no longer trust the media. And you should only trust journalists that prove themselves. And even then, if you're going to rely on what they said, you probably need to dig into what they did.
And, in fact, this text can be found at the top of an infographic that Sargon conveniently left out of the video when displaying this text.
Well, fuck, now you're just going to be stupid. Let's take a look at the article. Now, look how big this fucking graphic is. How in the fuck was Sargon supposed to take a screenshot of this graphic? And there's nothing here to hide. This would just further his point. You act like he's being dishonest, but the fucking graphic just wouldn't fit. By the way, this thing is sourced down here at the bottom, kinda. But still, you won't get very far following those goddamn links.
The infographic is designed to explain how you should be marketing to women, because they spend all the money. Because women fucking love shopping.
And your evidence that they don't like to shop in the U.S. is, I would guess, not forthcoming.
Am I right? Fucking love it. They just love shopping. They love going to the mall to buy, you know, bags and shoes and fucking, you know, tampons. It's stuff that women love.
You know what? Even a poorly sourced Business Insider article is more credible than your goddamn jibber-jabber nonsense. Only a fucking pea-brained, giddy feminist would be impressed by your pathetic attempt at humor here. The rest of us are not amused.
I found it rather difficult to find anything that resembles the figures that Sargon is putting forward here when looking into wealth distribution in the U.S.
Then you're not looking very hard, fucker. The claim that women do more of the spending is widely reported. The problem is journalists nowadays do a shitty job of tracking down where these numbers come from. It just takes a little elbow grease. But it didn't take me long to find Business Insider's latest article on this issue and track down where Sargon's number is coming from. And guess what? It's coming from a 2005 book entitled The Power of the Purse: How Smart Businesses Are Adapting to the World's Most Important Consumers, Women. So if you want to debunk the numbers, you have to buy the book. I'm not going to buy the book.
There are no nice, clean, women have X percent and men have Y percent of the wealth in the U.S. floating around the place, unless you're looking at business tip websites that are trying to make you market to women.
No, that's total bullshit. These numbers are precisely laid out. The issue is, you're not sure how they got to this number. But the number's clearly laid out, and I've tracked it down to the ultimate source for you. So, have fun. And for what it's worth, I think you should be skeptical of this number. That's perfectly fine. But don't be preaching to everybody as if you got to the bottom of this issue when you haven't done shit.
Wealth is typically measured at a household level, so as a result, wealth disparity data between men and women typically looks at single-parent households.
Jesus Christ, don't just gloss over that. This is something that folks need to spend a bit of time thinking about. Now, I happen to know there's been a few scholarly papers done on this subject. One was sponsored by TIAA-CREF, if my memory serves. And people can do their own research, but it boils down to this. It's virtually impossible to assign who has control of wealth in a couple. Well, until one of them dies, and that's usually the husband. But when they're both alive, one or two may make the money, assets may be in one or both of their names, and when it comes time to spend the money, it may be one or both of them making the decision. So I'll give you an example. My wife wanted a new car. I told her I would buy her one. I told her I would put X dollars towards it and suggested a model. Then she did all of the shopping and she did end up getting the make I suggested, but she went over a little bit, so she thought she was going to have to spend her own money, but I went ahead and wrote the check for the whole damn thing. Now, how much of that was my decision? How much was it her decision? And this car is for her, but it's titled in both of our names. So if anyone can get back with me on how much of this was my decision and how much of it was hers and how much of this asset belongs to me and how much it belongs to her, I'm not talking in the legal sense, I'm talking in the practical sense. And that's the problem with tracking a couple's wealth and attributing it to one sex or the other. This is an area where it's just a clusterfuck to look for solid, meaningful numbers.
That being said, existing research has found gender differences in wealth accumulation. Studies show that single male-headed and single female-headed households accumulate 9% and 15% less wealth, respectively, than married households, while single mothers accumulate the least amount of wealth overall. This seems to go contrary to what Sargon seems to be asserting.
Well, that's true insofar as your claim and your sources go. But surprise, surprise, neither your claim nor your citations are that compelling. So let's go take a look at your shit. Okay, we're going to look at the source of your information here. One's a study that is a long-term study of Wisconsin high school graduates from 1957. And the latest information from that group is now 12 years old. And this is about wealth accumulation. In other words, in a retirement account, who has the most money, the man that went to work or the women that worked less. But that's not what the article that Sargon cited is talking about. It's also talking about the fact that women, even if the money is in the husband's name, still makes decisions where that money goes. Neither one of your citations really incorporate that fact, as far as I can see. So let's take a look at your other study. This doesn't look like this study was done by an economist, but rather a sociologist interested in the advancement of women's issues. Now, the source of the sociologist's wealth data is kind of interesting here. It says, one reason income has been the conventional indicator of financial status is that it is easy to measure and data on wealth is more scarce. But large data sets that include data on wealth are now more common and include Consumer Expenditure Survey, Health and Retirement Study, National Longitudinal Surveys, Panel Study of Income Dynamics, Survey of Consumer Finances, and a Survey of Income and Program Participation. Each survey has its own strengths and weaknesses, but only SCF was designed specifically to measure wealth and is considered the most accurate source of information about the magnitude of wealth inequality because it oversamples high-income households who are likely to own the most wealth but are less likely to be included in random samples because they comprise such a small percentage of the population. The data in this fact sheet are derived from the 2007 SCF. This fact sheet uses the same definition of wealth employed by the Federal Reserve Board, except that the value of vehicles is not included here. And she says in her footnote the reason that she doesn't include the value of cars is they depreciate. But it would have been nice to know if men or women have a tendency to squander their wealth on overpriced luxury vehicles or something like that. I mean, after all, if you had a $50,000 to $80,000 car parked in your garage, that may account for why you don't have so much money left in your retirement accounts. Who knows? So the viewer should be cautioned about the source of this wealth data, as it is an oversampling of high-income households. And even then, the amount of wealth is not that much. And if you had happened to spend a large amount of money on vehicles, that could very well move these numbers significantly and tell a totally different narrative. So unfortunately, in my opinion, we don't have very good information here. However, they may have tried to correct for that somehow mathematically. I don't know. Okay, now we get to the graph, and what does this tell us? Well, we know men in the aggregate work more, and they work in more dangerous and higher-paying fields. And as a result of that, and savings and investment and spending habits, single women seem to have earned less and also saved less than men. Not much of a surprise there. And look here, married couples are in the best situation, and we know that even though that the money may mostly be in the man's name, we can be fairly certain that much of this money is spent in a way that the couples agree to. Moreover, the over 65 bracket looks really close. We're talking 85% of what a man has earned, and these are elderly women supposedly earning much less for their work back in the dinosaur age. Now let's look at the 18 to 64 age bracket. If women tend to spend their money on clothes, shoes, nicer cars, socializing, and men tend to stick to watching TV and playing video games, and they buy used cars. Well, who knows? Maybe the women are smarter for enjoying their wealth as it is earned. Keep in mind, this isn't how much wealth one has went through. This is a measure of how much wealth one has managed to hang on to. Two totally different things. So is this a picture of patriarchal oppression, or does it just highlight the spending habits of women compared to men and adjusted for the earnings gap? Without knowing the answers to these questions, this here fact sheet that we're looking at really isn't helpful as to answering whether or not society is treating women unfairly. Given the propensity to put women on a pedestal, for them to work less, and for men to buy them things, this may be more than they have earned. We just don't know. But as to the so-called control of money question, this would tend to debunk Sargon's citation if vehicles had been factored in, but they weren't, and so we just don't know. As to the owning of stock, this fact sheet has nothing to say on the issue. So as lousy as the Business Insider's support for its claim was, Strawface's argument and citations are a pretty good counterpunch, but ultimately, they do not debunk the Business Insider article. So I wish we had better data. I wish I had the book that the Business Insider led us to. I think that that's probably a crock of shit too, but I wish I had it to be sure. Also, I wish I was a statistician, because you can go into the raw data of the Survey of Consumer Finances. That's available from the Federal Reserve. But I just don't know that I would be competent in extrapolating conclusions out of it. I would definitely need some help with that. But the bottom line is this. Sir Strawface's citations certainly call into question, but fail to debunk Sargon's flimsily supported claim, or even demonstrate patriarchal oppression in any way, shape, or form.
Surprise! If we take a look at the richest of the rich, the Forbes 400, fucking Fat Cat Central. Fat Cat! We will see that only 13% of its members are women. In total, these women control $290 billion, which is only 10% of the total net worth of the Forbes 400, which is $2.29 trillion. That's trillion with a capital trill. These figures tell a rather different story to what Sargon would have us believe.
Well, for the sake of argument, I'm going to accept that as true. And from your perspective, it may shed some light on the stats Sargon was citing. But the stats that Sargon was citing probably didn't have anything to do with any billionaires at all. In fact, the fact sheet that we just covered didn't have anything to do with billionaires. We're just talking regular people. With respect to billionaires, like I said, for the sake of argument, I'm going to concede that as a fact. But it still doesn't even tend to prove patriarchal oppression. And the reason it doesn't is because of a study that I happened onto while I was going through your citations. So let's just take a look at this new information. So this is the 2014 State of Women-Owned Business Report commissioned by American Express Open. This report was published in March of 2014. The underlying data for this report comes from the past three census surveys here in the United States, and according to it, it's factored in relevant changes in gross domestic product, and with that information, it extrapolated its data forward to 2014. Here are the interesting tidbits I found. Between 1997 and 2014, when the number of businesses in the United States increased by 47%, the number of women-owned firms increased by 68%, a rate 1.5 times the national average. Indeed, the growth in the number up 68%, employment up 11%, and revenues up 72% of women-owned firms over the past 17 years exceeds the growth rates of all but the largest publicly traded firms, topping growth rates among all other privately held businesses over this period. Boy, that pretty much smashes to pieces your last video about CEOs, doesn't it? The only bright spot in recent years with respect to privately held company job growth has been among women-owned firms. They have added an estimated 274,000 jobs since 2007. Among men-owned and equally owned firms, employment has declined over the past 7 years. Boy, the patriarchy and its oppression, it's just devastating against women. It's just devastating. Women-owned firms now account for 30% of all enterprises and are growing faster in number and employment than most other firms. Despite this fact, women-owned firms employ only 6% of the country's workforce and contribute just under 4% of business revenues, roughly the same share they contributed in 1997. So if you were to look at that statement skeptically, you might say to yourself, I wonder if women should spend a little bit more time learning how to make more money. They own a lot of businesses, but they're having a hard time figuring out how to make money. Moving on, when large publicly traded firms are excluded, women-owned businesses comprise 31% of all privately held firms and contribute 14% of employment and 11% of revenues. And if you look here at this graph, you'll see that women-owned businesses outnumber men-owned businesses in almost every industry. Damn that patriarchy. It is so absolutely ineffective. It just blows one's mind. So at the very top of the pyramid, yes, you're going to find a disproportionate number of men up there. But here in the real world where most people live, women are doing just fine. Women are allowed to open their own businesses. And the only thing left for them to really do is to figure out how to make more money with their businesses. If there was a patriarchy, it wouldn't let women open all of these businesses. It wouldn't let women dominate education. So if women want their businesses to earn more money, they need to focus on that. As an economy, as a society, we don't want to bring down men's businesses because that will hurt everybody. So it's just up to women in the aggregate as to what they want to do with their businesses.
Oh! I would also remind you of the number of women that control the US government. I mean, I'm no expert on US political things. Can you tell? But it seems to me that the government would have some sort of control over the budget. And if men control the government, which we already established that they do, then it seems fair enough to assume that they might also have control over the money.
And if you were to guess that women got the lion's share of the health care and social services care dollars out of that budget, you'd be right. God damn, that patriarchy is cruel.
With over 1.3 million women earning over $100,000 plus annually and running 40% of all private American businesses.
If you follow the link after this claim, it will take you to a website called SheEconomy, which is a guy's guide to marketing to women. It's a page which lists a whole bunch of figures and claims about women and their spending habits. It does, in fact, assert that 1.3 million women earn more than 100K per year, but I couldn't find the study that it cited at all. So I took to Google to see if I could find the source of this elusive figure, this 1.3 million.
And you didn't find but shit, because you're so fucking incompetent. So let me clean up your fucking mess once again. As to the 1.3 million women earning over $100,000 per year, remember the Business Insider article is from 2012, and there is more recent information for us to look at. So if you do a quick search for women earning over $100,000, You should come across several articles that point out that this number is recorded by the U.S. Census Bureau. So if you go to their website and poke around just a little bit, you will find the current population survey, and it's broken down by sex. And if you grab the very top spreadsheet, you find these numbers. First note that the numbers in the spreadsheet are reported in the thousands. So the 5,070 females that earned 100,000 or more is actually 5,070,000 women. Do you see how easy this is and lazy you are, Sir Strawface? Well, I suppose you want to pass on your laziness to Sargon, but he was just looking for a reliable source to demonstrate that it is being widely reported that women are quite capable of making big bucks and have a lot of wealth, and the public is not going to believe this bullshit about the patriarchy when they have this information at their fingertips. Well, actually, I can't read his mind, but that's how you have to take what he was doing if you're going to be charitable. He's not actually trying to pass this number off as being checked and double-checked by economists with micrometers, but rather as a reasonable number that the public has been exposed to, given his overall argument. You, on the other hand, attempted to demonstrate how dishonest and sloppy Sargon was in his research, nitpicking all of his little points. And to do so, you've been going to great lengths to make this claim, but you're not able to come up with shit, even though you have all the time in the world to do so. Isn't that so, Sir Strawface? Anyway, when we compare those numbers to the numbers that Sargon was using, his case is made even stronger by getting the most current numbers available from the Census Bureau. This information would tend to lead the public to believe that women are not systematically oppressed, and they are perfectly able to earn big money if they put in the hard work. Yes, the Business Insider article is poorly sourced, so I personally wouldn't trust this as a source unless you can figure out where the numbers come from. And if you can't, then don't use the numbers from Business Insider. It's that simple. But if you recall the American Express sponsored report that we looked at earlier, it turns out that this report is prepared by Womenable, a company that states for itself, as our name implies, Womenable is focused on one thing, enabling women, and that Womenable is working to educate, enlighten, and empower women's entrepreneurship worldwide. Then if you go to their about page and just kind of generally check out their site, you will see that this company is women-ran and women-centered, to say the least. Now, the earlier cited American Express Open Report is a report that is done annually by Women Enable, and it's been updated for 2015. The executive summary is available, and it continues to state that women own 30% of firms outright, and women combined with equally owned businesses account for 47% of businesses. So remember that this report comes from the census surveys, and it factors in relative changes in the gross domestic product. One caution here, though, despite there being a 2012 survey by the Census Bureau, presumably this data continues to be extrapolated from the 2007 and earlier surveys. But anyway, there's a number for you that you know where the fuck it comes from. Whether it's legitimate or not, you can try to debunk it further if you want.
So I took to Google to see if I could find the source of this elusive figure, this 1.3 million, and what I found was kind of amusing to me. There were a bunch of other websites that parroted this figure, this 1.3 million, which all hope to educate you on how to market to women and the purchasing power of the woman. How do we sell to the woman? How do we get inside their heads? I've got a tip for you. If you want to market to women, take a leaf out of Bic's book. Paint all your shit pink, because if there's anything that women love more than spending, it's fucking pink. Just pink, 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 pink. Look, pink. Buy fucking pink, because you're a woman and you can't. That's purple. But you get the idea. Pink. Buy pink, because, you know, she's a good singer.
Now do you see why I keep saying that your research skills and you personally are fucking pathetic? Absolutely pathetic.
But sure, let's grant that 1.3 million women earn over $100,000 a year. Seems like a lot, right? Seems like a reasonable amount of women to be earning that much money. I mean, it's more than I can count on my fingers, so it must be a significant number. It seems reasonable. It seems I can feel it in my blood and my gut. It just seems right until you realize that you're supposed to be doing honest, unbiased research, so you use the internet for what it's there for rather than cats and porn, and you find that there are 10 times that many men earning that much. It's not that difficult to find, man. Come on!
Yeah, I don't know why you are so lazy. So if we take a look at your link, it takes us to the Quora website where you got your research information. And here it told you that these numbers come from the U.S. Census Bureau, which you didn't bother to check yourself. Nevertheless, you try to pass yourself off as such a thorough researcher. And you didn't bother to check or didn't bother to disclose that this very same researcher from the very same website using the very same set of data also reports the percentage of women that make over $100,000 a year. And guess what? There aren't 10 times as many men that earn over $100,000 as you claim. It's 3 times as many men. According to your own source, fucktard. You are so fucking pathetic, it's just fucking amazing. But anyway, anyone that wants to can go directly to the U.S. Census Bureau and get the data for 2014 themselves and check this information out. But you, the great researcher, was unable to do this for some fucking unexplained reason.
Jesus Christ! It's like going onto Google and searching up the population of the Asian elephant and seeing that it's about 45,000 and then going, well, yeah, that's a big number. That seems like a reasonable number of elephants for Asia to have. I can just stop my research there. I don't need to search for any more data points. I don't need any more to conclude that we don't live in a society which allows for the countless slaughter of these animals without any repercussion. And then you go onto your YouTube channel and you condemn all AJWs, that's animal justice warriors, for being speciesist, for trying to preserve the Asian elephant. It's just fucking stupid.
No. You are the one who's fucking stupid. That is a fucking huge straw man and a terrible analogy to boot. Sargon was not saying that women don't have issues and that women should not advocate for women. He was saying no such thing. Rather, he was saying that much of the populace, not him necessarily, but a large swath of the public, equate feminism to man-hatred. In part, due to this nebulous concept of the patriarchy that somehow allows women to do just fine when they roll up their sleeves and compete for good jobs. Sir Strawface, women aren't dying or even in decline in any way. They are surging. They are doing very well for themselves in the Western world. Even so, no one is claiming that women should not be supportive of other women pursuing their dreams. The only thing that's being questioned is whether or not feminism is disdained by the public for its over-the-top non-fucking sense. Fucking hell.
Also, I don't know where this 40% figure comes from. There's a couple of links on the She Economy website. One I followed and it was broken, and the other one I followed and it took me back to the original infographic.
Again, getting a good number was not hard at all. No, it wasn't the 40%, but it was 30 to 47%, depending on how you fucking calculate women-owned businesses. Piece of fucking cake to find this information.
And the infographic is right because the infographic says that it's right, and the infographic is right because it says that it's right, and the infographic is right because it sends you to another page which says that it's right, which then sends you back to the infographic which says that it's right. It's watertight reasoning right there. There's no way that that could be considered fallacious. The only study that I could find was from the small citation of Mass Mutual Financial Group 2007, which wasn't a link, by the way. I had to Google that phrase and take my best guess as to what the hell it was referring to. I found a study of American family businesses, which said that 24% had women as CEOs and 60% had women in upper level management. Great. So how does that mean that women control 40% of all private American businesses? I don't know. Reasons? Because the infographic says that it's right. Yeah. Okay. Good. Good. Science. I have no words for how lazy Sargon is with his research. Just beyond lazy. If you took a bucket full of koalas, a bucket full of sloths, and a bucket full of armadillos, laid them across a giant lazy Susan on a Sunday afternoon, that would still not be as lazy as this man is with his research. It's infuriatingly lazy. He may as well have just typed random letters into Google and pressed I'm feeling lucky and presented that as his evidence. That would have been just as convincing. It's like Ted Mosby in that episode of How I Met Your Mother, where he needs to go and get the hot wings from the pub, but he doesn't want to hear the score of the Super Bowl. So he puts on the sensory deprivator 5000, so he can't hear anything, and he can only see the smallest amount of stuff that he needs to see to accomplish his goal.
So when the average person returns to their definition of patriarchy, they're wondering, what the fuck are feminists talking about? Why don't we ask some?
That's a fucking great idea, Sargon. Why didn't you do that fucking 3 minutes ago rather than wasting our time on this bullshit charade of yours?
It's not bullshit, knucklehead. Sargon has laid out how many people come across the concept of patriarchy and the process of those people. That's the story he's been telling the whole time. But you're so fucking stupid, you can't follow the narrative. You must think that when Sargon or anyone else researches or writes a story, you must always go to the feminist first and do your research in the manner prescribed by the feminist. In your mind, the feminist is always right, and the feminist is always to be believed, and the feminist always gets to tell the story. Well, that ain't how the real world works, Sir Strawface. People are on different paths. Get used to it.
I mean, if you're going to address the feminist assertion that we live in a patriarchy, why bother with other definitions that are completely irrelevant to the definition that a feminist would give you of what the patriarchy is?
To compare rational thinking to lunacy. That's why. Seriously, you need to check into a cult intervention center because you are drowning in the Kool-Aid. Why bother with your own ideas about society when feminists have a ready-made ID all prepackaged for you? You should be trying to think for yourself, mate. No wonder feminism attracts dullards. For fuck's sake, man, listen to yourself. Let's just speed past your ad hominems that have no argument in them here, shall we?
I mean, can you imagine if someone like, say, William Lane Craig argued against atheism by using a definition of atheism that was completely irrelevant to the definition that an atheist would give to the...
I would expect him to do exactly that if the atheist was trying to use a definition of atheism that would mislead the public. He should definitely start off from the point of helping the public understand that their concept of the word atheism and the concept of the word atheism with the person who he was arguing with were two different things. You would want to make that clear at the very start of the debate and make it very clear for the audience.
Bad example. Ray Comfort. Can you imagine if Ray Comfort argued against evolution by using a definition of evolution that was...
As well he should if the evolutionist is trying to change the definition of the very word. This should be brought to the public's attention.
Another bad example, sorry. Ken Ham. Can you imagine if Ken Ham argued against the Big Bang Theory by using a definition of the Big Bang Theory that was...
It's like you don't even know how normal debate works. When there is a question of the definition of a word, the debaters either agree on the definition or they argue what the definition is. That's how a debate works. Sir Strawface.
Leafing through the South China Morning Post, an opinion piece caught my eye. It said that many Chinese government officials have young mistresses. They are called little thirds, signaling vast differences of age and power. I posted a tweet about it, adding the hashtag patriarchy. I remember that moment with stinging pain. Just hours before arriving in Hong Kong for a conference, I had filed for divorce, ending in a day and a half a marriage that had lasted a decade and a half. I had mistaken the immense betrayal that had unfolded in my life, the little thirds I had not known about, as infidelity. That was not it. It was patriarchy.
Like me, you're probably confused as to what this clearly privileged woman...
I like how completely irrelevant that statement was.
I find it kind of funny that I'm looking at a feminist who doesn't see the interrelation or relevancy between the concept of privilege and patriarchy. Are women supposedly oppressed by the patriarchy or not? I like your math skills here, Sir Strawface.
Don't tell me that one and one are numbers that can add up to something.
You are the densest wood that has ever been found in New Zealand, I am sure.
Is talking about patriarchy is her husband cheating on her, I think?
No. Patriarchy is the social system which allows for men to exploit women in this way without much opposition or repercussion.
You know, it's funny how you can over and over and over again fail to understand Sargon's points and then toss out a straw man on him. But then when a woman says something, you nail it on the head. I wonder what that tells us about the rat poison you've been eating. Anyway, I don't know what planet you've been living on, fucktard, but women get divorced all the time because they want a new sex partner. They cheat on men all of the time. And the women often end up getting alimony and welfare as a result. In other words, no consequences, only benefits. So when are you and this ridiculous speaker going to start going after the matriarchy that allows such disloyal and despicable behavior? Oh, that's right. I forgot. Feminists talk about equality, but always promote double standards that favor women. I forgot there for a second, my bad. Go ahead and continue your hypocritical analysis.
She explains it literally 7 seconds after you stop the video.
What I had thought was a marriage between equals had turned out to be a relationship of profound inequality, in which male power required the subordination of women, either as dependent little thirds or as wives who were not worthy of fidelity and honesty.
Like I said, as if women were never deceptive and never cheated on men. To see the world in this way is delusional. It's insanity.
I mean, he can't even watch more than a minute and a half of a video in an attempt to try and understand what this woman is talking about.
Hey, moron. Fucking moron. She's describing cheating as the patriarchy. I think Sargon nailed it.
I mean, Sargon, I know... Let's talk real. Let's real talk. I know that you're used to only just reading the title of an article and coming to a conclusion based on that.
Bullshit, Sir Strawface. One of Sargon's shticks is reading most of these articles and then commenting on portions within the article. You can't do that unless you read the fucking article, dipshit.
But let's be honest, if you want to try and start forming, you know, honest, well-informed opinions about things, perhaps you want to start reading a little bit more than just the title, or watching more than a minute and a half of a video. I know that it's difficult to concentrate for more than a minute and a half, I totally understand it, but... If you're going to make a video about something, and you're going to do some research about that thing, perhaps you want to watch the video for more than a minute and a half. You're not really going to develop any deep, nuanced understandings of things if you're only watching for a minute and a half. Just a tip. Wow. If you'd been really committed and watched all the way to 4 minutes of this video, I know, 4 minutes, wow, that's just, like, outrageous. 4 whole minutes, that's, like, fucking 240 seconds. That's a long time. But if you'd done that, you would have seen that she gives a concise definition of what she is talking about when she talks about patriarchy. You know, defining your terms. Like this.
And I do so using an old-fashioned word, patriarchy, which implies a social system of male power exercised not only through domination, but also through benevolence and protection, even love.
Yeah, let's just listen to the lead-up to what you call the concise definition of patriarchy.
I remember looking out over the wet foliage of the lush hotel gardens, the rattle of my teacup, the rustle of the newspaper. And most of all, I remember that word as I typed it on my iPhone. Patriarchy. I had mistaken the immense betrayal that had unfolded in my life, the little thirds I had not known about, as infidelity. That was not it. It was patriarchy. There was a betrayal of love for sure, but there was also a betrayal of equality. What I had thought was a marriage between equals had turned out to be a relationship of profound inequality, in which male power required the subordination of women, either as dependent little thirds or as wives who were not worthy of fidelity and honesty. Suddenly, that noisy restaurant fell silent. My phone stopped beeping. The world stood still. It had happened to me. Patriarchy had happened to me? Raised by my parents to be strong and strong-willed, finding my way to the U.S. alone at the age of 18, succeeding on my own terms in academia, I was not the sort of woman to whom patriarchy happened. A scholar of gender and poverty, I studied the lives of poor women as they eked out survival amidst exploitation and oppression. My life was different. But it is to me that patriarchy happened. On that stormy morning, it slapped me in the face. After Hong Kong, I went to Kolkata, the city of my birth. And there two women, Bula and Kalpana, held my hand and said, Didi, ei nesha kate na, apni pechone takaben na. Elder sister, this addiction cannot be remedied. Don't look back. But I was not their elder sister. I was the daughter of their employer. In a city awash in poverty, they worked as maids in an assembly line of middle-class homes. One lived with a husband she adored, the other with an alcoholic husband and abusive son. Across the great divide of social class, they held my hand and made me promise never to bargain with patriarchy. I'm here today to share what I'm learning from this experience. And I do so using an old-fashioned word, patriarchy, which implies a social system of male power exercised not only through domination, but also through benevolence and protection, even love.
And it just goes on and on and on and on of her rambling out nonsense after nonsense. My take on what she's saying is anything that she doesn't like, she blames patriarchy for, and mostly the fact that her husband cheated on her. Anybody can take anything they want out of what that crazy bitch said. And that's exactly Sargon's point. Incoherent rambling is often what you get when you talk to feminists about the patriarchy. Case fucking closed.
But, you know, Sargon, bad at research, lazy, unbiased, totally unbiased, definitely not biased at all about these things.
Well, I'm glad you feel that way. Since feminists are biased towards feminism, then they shouldn't be allowed to report on the subject whatsoever at any time for any reason. I'm all for that. You fucking retarded fucking hypocrite. In all of part 5, would it have been too much to ask if you would have made at least one intelligent, legitimate point? Is that too much to ask, you goofy, goofy fuck?
Maybe we should ask someone else.
It's always about the patriarchy. You can't argue that. So I'm going to try to actually defend these feminists and say that basically, yeah, everything kind of can be blamed on the patriarchy.
So patriarchy seems to have a subjective definition for each feminist who is using it, and it seems to be omnipresent. Everything in society can be blamed on the quote-unquote patriarchy.
That's not what omnipresent means. Just saying. Just so you know. You might want to go and check the dictionary definition of that.
Well, you might want to consult a book on grammar, dipshit. First off, Sargon said that apparently the patriarchy is omnipresent. So that was covered. And in a second sentence, if you want to be charitable, which you should be, he stated also that apparently everything can be blamed on the patriarchy. That's exactly what this feminist is saying, and that's what I took from the incoherent ramblings of the previous feminist. Sure, you can be a contrarian cunt and read what Sargon said like this, which would be terrible sentence structure, or you can be charitable, which is the trademark of a credible scholar, and read what Sargon said like this. But either way, your nitpickery is pointless.
Don't worry, don't bother. Also, I like how you didn't even listen to her definition of patriarchy or her defense of patriarchy.
For all we know, he did listen to her and all of the other videos completely. He's not doing a response video where you replay the whole video of the person you're responding to. Fuck, you're a feminist and you're not playing their whole videos. Your nitpickery is fucking ridiculous. Address the argument, shit for brains. If he missed something critical to his point or something in there is critical to your point from those videos, fucking play it. It's your fucking video. Do what the fuck you want in regard to their videos. But fucking play it or shut the fuck up about it. Jesus Christ. This is Sargon's response to Emma Watson, and it's not in the full response format. It's not about her video so much as that he's presenting a narrative why people seem to hate feminism, basically. So yes, when he uses somebody else's material, he needs to be fair about it. But he doesn't need to run their video entirely. Jesus Christ, what the fuck is wrong with you? His excerpts have been fair with these feminists. Maybe not what you would take from the videos, but nevertheless a fair representation of what I, he, and others would easily take away when listening. Only a pinheaded cult member like yourself is going to say otherwise. It boggles the mind that you are unable to differentiate between video genres / formats. You are just fucking ridiculous. Let's just speed through your attempt at comedy here.
Definitely a possibility. It's not necessarily that you're being dishonest, I suppose. I don't want to go accusing you of things. I'm just pulling your leg. Of course I do. I've been doing that this whole time. You're dishonest. You're a liar, and I'm about to show you why.
In fact, it rather sounds like feminists are talking about society itself.
So for those of you who live under a rock, the patriarchy is essentially this idea that men have the power in society. And feminists essentially want to eradicate that and make everybody equal.
Okay, this is more specific, even if it does raise more questions. But at least we can be sure that we're not talking about any known dictionary definition of patriarchy.
Ah, Sargon. Sargy, Sargy, Sargy. You are a liar. You are a fucking liar. First, you cherry-pick your definition of patriarchy, and then you double down by lying about the existence of a definition that you excluded yourself. And I know you saw it because it's right below the definitions that you show on your page. Not to mention that it's right there at the top of the fucking page when you Google search it. I even did a Bing search. A Bing search. Who does that? A Chandler Bing search. Chandler Bing. Who does that? No one does that. And it's the same over there. It's the same. It's the same. You're a liar. You are such a fucking liar. Let's have a listen to what she has to say one more time.
The patriarchy is essentially this idea that men have the power in society. Men have the power in society.
But at least we can be sure that we're not talking about any known dictionary definition of patriarchy.
Men have the power in society. The power in society. The power in society.
If there was ever any doubt that Sargon was a deceptive, lying asshole, there's not. There shouldn't be. There's just no doubt. There is no doubt. Liar.
Finally, some legitimate criticism. Bravo. I'm not going to defend Sargon on this. In my opinion, he's clearly wrong and should own up to it. I wouldn't go so far as to say he's lying, but he's certainly wrong, and he had no basis to say, quote, "At least we can be sure that we are not talking about any known definition of patriarchy," unquote. So yes, hold his feet to the fire. I think you got him there. I think he deserves getting his nose rubbed into that statement. You're on track here, and the sad thing is you never had to pretend to be a scholar or a researcher and become a liar yourself to do this legitimate criticism right here that you've done. That being said, in logic, you don't get to discount everything your opponent says just because he stepped into it at one point. If that were the case, I could have stopped long ago dealing with your nonsense. Although, in my opinion, you definitely won this point, and if I were him, I would post a correction in the show notes. But you still haven't addressed the larger issue. The larger issue is that Sargon is highlighting that depending on which feminist you talk to, you're going to get a different definition. And Sargon, although he represented that the men having the most power in society definition was not a known dictionary definition, he is nevertheless covering that definition as used by feminists. And he's contrasting that with the average person's understanding of what a patriarchy is. That being the primary definition, where the lines of the family are vested with the male, basically. I happen to agree with Sargon that this is how most people perceive the word. I could be wrong, but enough people will perceive the word in this way. And when they encounter a feminist talking about the patriarchy for the first time, they are going to think that the feminist is batshit stupid. That's ultimately his point, and you're failing to debunk that point whatsoever.
So at this point, we are 6.5 minutes into this video, and we are still not really sure what feminists are talking about when they're talking about patriarchy.
Perhaps that could be explained by the fact that you're a deceptive, lying asshole. This whole first 6 minutes could have been skipped.
And that is honestly because feminists aren't sure what they're talking about when they're talking about patriarchy.
No, it's because you're a deceptive, lying asshole.
No, that's a non sequitur. Sargon's invalid claim about known definitions does not invalidate his claim that feminists aren't even sure amongst themselves as to what patriarchy is. Just because Sargon made one illegal forward pass, it doesn't mean that all the other yards he gained are taken away from him. That's not how this shit works, you fucking retard.
Dear feminists, can you see why people are getting pissed off with your ideology?
No, because up until this point you haven't even touched on a feminist definition of patriarchy.
That's bullshit, Sir Strawface. He's covered 3 feminists that have tried to give us the definition of patriarchy, and one of those definitions is the definition that you're so proud of. So if you think Sargon's a liar, you need to look in the mirror, you dumb fucker.
There was going to be one, but you cut her off before she got to it. Oh, but then there was that other one. Yeah, but you cut her off before she got to it as well. And then you disregarded the next one because it wasn't like any known dictionary definition of patriarchy, except it totally was, and you lied, you fucking liar. You can't spell liar without Sargon of Akkad. It's totally true because I read it on businessinsider.com, so there.
So the most direct description of patriarchy I found was on everydayfeminism.com, where they say, although most of us know what a patriarchy is, a system of domination by the wealthy, white, male ruling class that has authority over everyone else, few of us understand how it plays out in our everyday lives. This definition is wonderfully concise and tells us absolutely everything we need to know about the feminist perception of the patriarchy, or at least this feminist perception of the patriarchy. This definition has a decidedly Marxist slant. The wealthy white males are now considered a ruling class that has authority over everyone else. But as we've already seen, this definition completely ignores women who command political and economic power, of which there is no small number. So finally, let's try Wikipedia. Maybe they have some kind of definition of patriarchy that we can use. A definition that actually reflects reality.
Before we get to Sir Strawface's response, please note that I cut out, I don't know, three and a half minutes of nonsense right at the start. And I'm just going to continue to cut out as much of his goofiness as I can and still leave his points in place. Anyway, the link to his video will be in the low bar in case anybody wants to suffer more of this fool.
According to that definition, 20% is in fact a minority.
Yes, 80% of office holders are a majority of office holders. Thank you for that brilliant analysis. But a majority is not a ruling class, moron. A ruling class is something altogether different. For example, in a monarchy, the ruling class is the nobility, a handful of people. If you're not a member of the nobility or the royal family, you can't rule, period. In a modern representative democracy, there is no ruling class, because citizens, regardless of class, regardless of religion, regardless of ideology, regardless of heritage, regardless of race, regardless of wealth, and regardless of sex, are free to participate in the political process. The fact that women hold 20% of the seats in the U.S. at the federal level proves that they can hold power regardless of their sex. There is no class bar to holding an elected office in a modern representative democracy. All you have to do is run for office and collect enough votes, and bam, you're an office holder. Women are obviously capable of doing this. They are allowed to do it and, in fact, encouraged to do it. And they can participate in the process any way they want to, just the same as men. They even get support that's just not available to men. So your straw man about men holding a majority of offices is true, but stupid. Because the fact does not make men a ruling class. Sargon's right. The everydayfeminism.com definition does not apply to the reality of a modern-day democracy. All you have done here is show that you don't know what the term ruling class means. Well, to be fair, you've got a good counterpoint. 80% of the offices being held by men here in the U.S. at the federal level is certainly an issue worth looking at. But it in no way makes Sargon wrong as to the everydayfeminism.com definition. It simply shifts the conversation, and you have every right to do that. But trying to act like Sargon is wrong makes you the fool, not him. Sargon actually agrees with you that 80% of the government offices are being held by men, but this doesn't seem to meet the requirements of most of the definitions of patriarchy that you, he, or I have looked at here. Let's just take a look at some of these definitions. From the dictionaries, I'll select the one that most likely supports your idea that a patriarchy is when a majority of government offices are held by men. Dictionary.com entry number 3. A social system in which power is held by men through cultural norms and customs that favor men and withhold opportunity from women. Now your concept completely fails here because opportunity has to be withheld from women. So this definition doesn't work because not only do women have the opportunity to hold elected government offices, 20% of the time, at the federal level, they actually do hold the office. Everydayfeminism.com by Marina, what the fuck, I can't pronounce that. A socio-political and culture system that values masculinity over femininity. Your concept here is not proven because all you have is correlation. You don't have proof of causation. All you have is the possibility that modern democracies are patriarchies. In fact, I kind of agree somewhat that modern democracies fit this definition, but not because of the reasons you state. I think that the meritocracy and getting shit done without whining about pointless shit is seen by our societies as a masculine trait. Therefore, in that regard, our culture does tend to favor that aspect of masculinity. But the problem with this is that our society also places women on a pedestal to be protected and favored and coddled. So this definition ultimately doesn't reflect reality either, because different aspects of so-called masculinity is favored over femininity, and vice versa, depending on the context. Everydayfeminism.com by Shannon Ridgway. A system of domination by which the wealthy, white male, ruling class has authority over everyone else. This definition fails the reality test as well, because the poor, minorities, and women all hold government offices in our society, therefore proving that there is no such ruling class. Had the definition said that an overrepresented demographic that holds a majority of offices is a patriarchy, then your concept would be valid under that definition, but that isn't what this definition says. Merriam-Webster.com, Entry 1. A family, group, or government controlled by a man or a group of men. This one arguably works for your concept, so I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt here. The doubt in my mind comes from it being ambiguous as to whether or not a group of men control government when they share that control with women. But let's give that one to you just for argument's sake. OxfordDictionaries.com, Entry 1.1. A system of society or government in which men hold the power and women are largely excluded from it. This one fails because you can't say women are largely excluded from holding office. In fact, at the bureaucratic level, that is, government employees and appointees, I believe we're a lot closer to 50-50. So it's just too much of a stretch to say that women are, quote, largely excluded, unquote, from it. Again, if this definition had said underrepresentation at the elected office positions in government, your concept would work under this definition, but that's not what this definition says. Wikipedia.org Feminist Theory Entry. An unjust social system that enforces gender roles and is oppressive to both men and women, often including any social mechanism that evokes male dominance over women. Well, this one doesn't prove your concept at all, and it doesn't work in reality either because there is no unjust social system that enforces gender roles, unless you want to count men being forced to financially support children that they did not agree to support, and for men being treated more harshly by the criminal justice system than women. But the second part of this definition really undermines such an interpretation. But anyway, your concept is not proof of a patriarchy under this definition. Wikipedia.org General Entry. A social system in which males hold primary power, predominant in roles of political leadership, moral authority, social privilege, and control of property. So your concept would fit within this definition of patriarchy, but it doesn't prove it. And there are some serious reality issues if you try to apply this to the West. I don't see where men hold primary power. That's a pretty nebulous concept. Also, I don't see where men are predominant in moral authority and predominant in social privilege and predominant in the control of property. Of those, maybe we can nail down that men have primary ownership of property. But as we discussed earlier, control of property is something a little bit different. And in a relationship, it's a very complex thing to nail down. And we also know that ultimately women statistically hold primary control of the final disposition of the wealth of the marital estate. But in any case, men holding a majority of elected positions in government doesn't prove this definition. So, out of the 7 definitions, being charitable, your concept only proves one of them. So while you got a point for debunking Sargon's claim, quote, at least we can be sure that we are not talking about any known definition of patriarchy, unquote, claim, you've managed only to strengthen his overall point. Feminists don't understand what the fuck they mean when they use the term patriarchy. You don't understand ruling classes, social classes, opportunity, exclusion, withholding, enforcement, representation, control, justice, oppression, dominance, moral authority, privilege, and meritocracy, just to name a few of the concepts that are befuddling you stupid fucks. You make regular people's heads spin because you don't know how to describe what the fuck you're talking about. And it pisses people off that no, you're fucking talking nonsense. You're pissing people off that know the difference between correlation and causation. You're pissing people off that know the difference between merit and malfeasance. You guys are fucking retarded numbskulls.
That means that the examples you have given, 20% of women in Congress, 20% of women in the House of Representatives, 4.8% of women who are CEOs, show as examples that women are a minority in these positions of power. And stands to reason that if women are the minorities in these positions of power, that who are the majority of the people in the positions? Let's take a look at some more fun, fantastic, fabulous facts and figures.
No, let's not, because the article that you cited doesn't cite where it got its information from. And we know that you would never ever do that because of the Business Insider article. So if people want to see you be a hypocrite, they'll need to watch your video. And the only thing that your numbers prove is that women are a minority in a lot of areas of life. That does not make men a ruling class. I'm sorry. It just doesn't.
I mean, at this point, Sargon has been so ridiculously dishonest and deceitful that I could just disregard the whole rest of the video. But I'm not gonna, because I'm such a swell guy. Gonna press on. Press on! Onward and upward!
Well, I noticed that you've started a different series, so maybe you will continue critiquing Sargon, maybe you won't. If you do, I'll be here waiting, and if I have to, I'll post an addendum to this video. But as it stands now, basically you are completely discredited, you don't know what the fuck you're doing, you haven't debunked shit, and you haven't really addressed Sargon's arguments whatsoever. So maybe you'll just stick to being a fucking goofy idiot and quit trying to pass yourself off as some kind of intellectual investigator, because you, Sir Strawface, you have been operating completely outside of your capacity. See you later, numbnuts. We'll be right back.
You're stealing my eyes.